Sister Ava, Ruth Ava Sam, they're performing. And guess what? We have her on set this morning. We're honored to have with us. She's a spiritualist and she practices African sacred science. And we're very curious to find out what that is all about. Welcome.
Welcome.
What is African sacred science all about?
Oh, African sacred science. Well, for me and for many like us, first I must say Abuya Boya Boshishe. I am just greeting in our song. I am an Orisha devotee, but actually I don't believe in religion at all. Religion is man-made. I believe in that connection with you and the ultimate, whatever you deserve or desire to call the superior being. This superior being have no gender, is neither male or female. So when we send that vibes out in the universe, it's your connection. And to know this connection even more, we study nature. So you wouldn't want to pollute the rivers. You wouldn't want to pollute the sea. You tell yourself, listen, I am a planetarian. So I have to treat everyone like how I want to be treated. So I will see a Hindu down the road and I can love you. I'll see a Muslim and I can love you. It doesn't matter what it is. We are humans and we have to exist on this planet. That is who I am, and that is how I portray Sister Ava.
Okay, so this is essentially what African sacred science is all
yes,
about?
Yes, it is vast, because okay. In African sacred science, you get, it might have voodoo, but I mean, everybody singing this song is the voodoo in your, you know, and it's a whole joke, but it is really part of the African sacred science. It's part of the culture, the slave trade, when they came from, let's say, Africa. I don't really like to say the word slave, but that's what it is. And they came to this diaspora. They brought a lot of the practices with them. But then again, you remember, the tongue was taken away, the name and everything was taken away. So the little that the tribes, and that's another name that they call them, but the little that the tribes could remember on how they worship, how the ancestors will worship, they merge and they put it together.
All right.
When they get in the different part of the Caribbean, they put them in a church, right? They put them in a Catholic church. So they look up and they saw St. Michael, St. Paul, St. this and that. And they say, hear what? I still have to practice so my generation could know who I am. And they could know that they're royal and they could know that they're powerful. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mask this thing. So if I look up and I see St. Michael and he all in red and I know in my tongue, that's Ogun, I will keep that in mind, but I go to see St. Michael.
Okay.
So they mask everything. So again, I don't really want to synchronize the thing, mm-hmm. but for people to understand what it is that we are one people, I have to synchronize it. So you could know, you would say the sea, St. Anne's or St. Philomen, and I would say Imanja, but we're speaking about the sea. You know, so that's basically what it
right.
is. Yeah.
So what is your musical journey all about? When did it begin for you?
Well, I went to the Gomartin Junior Secondary School back in the day. And at that time, we were, our pan teacher was Selwyn Taradat. And he taught us a lot in music. We were affiliated with Pamberry Phase 2. We were affiliated with Phase 2 Steel Orchestra. So my musical journey started there. Within that time, I thought I was a Jamaican. So I used to rap, I used to sing reggae because the 12 Tribe was, you know, booming at that time. The HQ wasn't too far down in the Gomartin. It's still there, the headquarters is still there. And I used to adore the way the men and the women will dress and the way they will greet the younger one, sistren, brethren. You know, you can be lyman on the street. I love the way they eat, the diet, everything. So I was attracted to that. So I was a Jamaican. I thought that is where that was at the time. And in the evolution of coming to self, one day, looking at the television, I saw this band on the stage. And they look like Jamaican too, right? Because they had the ice cold and green on. And then I see the bell. That was Resistance, right? So when I see the bell, okay. I say, well, boy, he ain't sounding like a Jamaican. And he looking like a Baptist, right? But I was close to spiritual Baptist as well because I was booted from that.
Okay.
Right? My mother, who was transcended not too long ago, she was a matriarch in that field, you know, where she had her healing school. Mm-hmm. So we were into that kind of a practice. I'm still a part of that. So I'm watching the merging of Resistance, singing this song with this bell, that's Ring the Bell.
Mm-hmm.
He have on the eyes gold and green. He have this steel pan as his identity, and he have his tongue. So I say, you know, I don't have this tongue like a Jamaican. I want to do that. I want to be Trini because I am Trini, but I want to be Rutical too, you know. And sometimes when you think things into, not sometimes, all the time, according to where you think and where you send out, it will come back to you. Because it wasn't long after that, a friend said, listen, there is a workshop for Breaking New Grounds. It's a Rapso workshop. You want to go? And I said, Rapso workshop? He said, his name is Kevin, Kevin Devines. He said, yeah, let's go. And we formed this little group, Vogue Production, and we decided to go this workshop. We've been to the workshop. That was 1995. And we met Resistance, we met, no one knew him before, but not at that part of him. We met Karaga Mandela, Brother Book, Wendell Man Warren. They were the mm-hmm. elders that were steering the ship for the Rapso movement, you know, and they put us in little blocks and then they start training us the dimension and the diction and how to perform your piece. Then we learned that we had to write for ourselves. You know, we had to right. be that kind of a person that have to come out from us to learn to write, and we had to learn to perform it with all the paper. You know, so you're on the stage and the paper shaking so because you don't know if you can remember. And for me, I didn't have a voice. I always had a vision. I could always talk to a sister and a brother, but to go on that lights, camera, and action, that wasn't happening for me. And I guess Resistance saw that. So he decided, watch me, that will be my personal project. You know? I used to feel, God, why are he treating me so dread, boy? Why it is that he always putting me out in front of the camera with his mic, afraid to hold the mic, it falling, so whatever. Eventually, I got there.
Mm-hmm.
We broke new grounds, and that was it.
And here
so from, are. Yes, so 1995, I ain't turned back at all. And I ain't intend to turn back no time soon.
What is the message in your music?
The message is in my music basically is, again, the awareness of self, knowing self, family, being family-oriented, love thy fellow man, things like that. That is the message. And I guess this time in my life, I really would love the people to know self, know your worth, respect each other. You know, I might say again that, and most people might get offended, but religion ain't mean nothing to me at all. That is just a man way of trying to guide you. But the ultimate God way of trying to guide you, that means everything to me. You know, so I try to direct everything in that order. Your ori, use your ori. You have to know what is right and what is wrong. And if you don't know what is right, you sit with self. Sit within self and you ask that question. Nothing wrong in talking to your elders. Nothing wrong with that because they would have been there already. So I am into that as well, you know.
How has African sacred science benefited you or transformed your life?
Well, I have born into African sacred science, as I say, is ancestral.
Mm-hmm.
So getting in the Rapso and the oral tradition, that strengthened it even more because it is the oral tradition from the ancestors.
Where is your music currently being played?
Well, you know, there is a hiccup with our music. There's a hiccup with Kaiso on the whole. Mm-hmm. You would hear the soca. You ain't going on here calypso, far less the rap so. So they have a station, Resistance, and they are on the radio on a Saturday. I can't remember which one of the station, but you will hear the music played there and then. And honestly, to give all credits, I really don't pay attention. Because I am so accustomed with the cries of our music not being played, I don't pay attention at all. I really go, if I have to go to the schools, the communities, wherever it takes us as a little caravan to go and teach, and not vocally, we do dance, we do drums, just name it. It's a whole holistic thing. Mm-hmm. So I am busy and tied up with that kind of activities, ready to sit down and listen. You know, they ain't playing my music. No, I don't.
What are some of the names of the songs that you have?
Well, the latest one that I did at Kaiso House this year, Rise Up. And this was a song that I would say my mother, she put her energies into it. Although she's on the other side, it was really something that a mother would want to see her daughter not just sit and grieve away and stuff when they has passed on, you know. So the latest one is Rise Up. You probably would have heard Black Rose, The Ghetto, Feel Like Crying. You probably would have heard these songs in the... This is a lot, eh?
Right.
It's a lot, but I had to take my licks for it. I don't really...
You don't follow up?
I don't follow up. I don't perform it, so...
What's next for you on the agenda? What can we expect?
What's next? Well, right now I'm trying to take back my community. And it is a struggle, but we will get there. And I started with Oxford and Charlotte Street. Our store, Drumline Uprising, is at the corner of Oxford and Charlotte Street, where it is also an educational center where we partner with Trinity College Canada, and they would come and do workshops with us and stuff like that when they have to write a thesis and stuff like that. And that area is in a form of a little crisis right now, the little violence and crime and stuff. But I see the love, and I saw... I saw what that area has to offer.
Potential.
The potential. And because we're talking the Harp, so that's history, all Quarry Street, Lavanty, all that. We're talking these areas that were once very vibrant and has given us some history. So we are situated right there, and we're trying to make the best of what we could with it. So we're going to bring back the drum classes. If it had to be on the street, say what? Instead of the children using their hands to shoot somebody, to play with that instrument of destruction, they will have to play with the drums.
Okay.
So we want to bring that back. We want to bring even food. We are into food, health food and stuff. We want to bring that a little portion of that back. Little workshops on that limbo dance. We have to find a space right here. I don't know how we're going to do it yet because it's a small store. Mm-hmm. But we're going to start it, and that's where my energies are right now.
All right, and our closing 15 seconds, what would you like to say?
I would like to say give thanks for life. This time in our life is really crucial. You know, you're here now, and you just go outside and boom, bang, you're gone, you know. We always have to keep it in our mind that we have to give thanks for every breath that we take. Always smile, look for the best in others. You know, that's really my message.
Great. Yeah. Give thanks, live peaceably among others. We've been chatting with Sister Ava. She's Ruth Ava Sam.